Dear friends of PowerShoots TV, positive energy in Europe. Today I'm in Brussels and I'm really happy to present Janez Potocnik. He's the co-chair of the United Nations International Resource Panel and partner Systemic. Welcome.
Thank you.
So your presentation is so difficult and your working field is also so large, and it's very difficult to explain everything you do, but please explain us a little bit short, what are you doing and how citizens in Europe benefit of your work, and for sure the Earth, because you work on the Earth, on the environment.
We are actually a science policy interface. We do pretty similar work like the colleagues are doing in so-called International Panel for Climate Change. They are very known, you know, that a lot of decisions which are based in climate change are based on this scientific work which is done by them. You have also recently heard that the panel which is called IPBS, that's our colleagues which are working on biodiversity, has released a report which is pretty shocking on the disappearing life, on disappearing biodiversity. And we, International Resource Panel, are dealing with the resources, with the resource management, how they are important for the life of people, how they are influencing to the economic issues. So we basically deal with biomass, metals, non-metallic materials, fossil fuels, land and water. So anything what matters.
And yeah, the biggest problem is, I would say, the waste of these resources. How do you manage now? What is now, for example, a real action? What are you doing to manage this problem?
We always try to provide scientific data to policymakers and to the public that they can see what would be the consequences if we would continue with the way how we produce and consume today. What would be the consequences, which, by the way, everybody already is seeing in our life. The most typical things which you see in daily life, it's, for example, connected to the plastics, which has overloaded our lives. You can see it also in the food which we are throwing away. We are throwing away, by the way, 1/3 of the food which we produce, which means that we throw away 1/3 of all the land, 1/3 of all the water which we use, 1/3 of pesticides which we use, 1/3 of the energy which is used for that production. So it's immoral and also economically irrational. So these are the questions which we deal concretely, and of course we deal with many other issues, but we simply try to provide scientific evidence from which people and policymakers can then conclude what would be the necessary policies, what would be the necessary actions that those things would not repeat.
Yeah, because you work also as a commissioner for environment, and then you work already, or many people, many scientists, and many people work on it since many, many years. And people now in the street, they complain, they say, yes, but why? What did you do and why did not change so lot? Why we are so far? When I see, for example, with plastic, which is now the thing, that you have only 8 rivers in the world who pollute so much, that's actually, what is 8 rivers? That's nothing. Why we cannot manage this? Or why is the biggest problem? Why is the challenge?
It's actually not rivers which are polluting. It's practically all problem of plastic emerge from the land. It emerge from the production and consumption of us humans. And unfortunately, in many cases in the past, we have not considered that as a problem. We have created an economic system in which, if I simplify, financial capital, it's overvalued and overrewarded. Human capital is undervalued and underrewarded, and natural capital, it's in many cases not valued and not rewarded at all, which means that we are incentivizing the producers and consumers to destroy the environment. So we are indebting socially and environmentally next generations. Yeah. That's why it is necessary that we start dealing with those questions in a different way. So basically there are 3 major reasons which I see behind why this is happening. The first one is that in all political cycles, in all policy making, in public institutions and in financial institutions, we have pretty much short-term based thinking.
Okay.
So we don't think long term,
okay,
while the challenges which we are facing request a lot of systemic thinking and longer term view. The second reason is that we have created an economic system which is based on consumerism. It is quantity driven and fueled economic growth. And of course, this has its consequences. The producer has more profit if he's selling you more products.
Sure,
but
sure.
At the end, for example, you don't need a light bulb, you need light.
Yeah.
And if he would be selling you the light, for example,
yeah,
a contract for a yearly light which he or she would provide you, the interest of the producer would be to sell you as few light bulbs. So he would make profit of making and selling less light bulbs but more light. Yeah. So it's possible, you know, because at the end of the day, if we revert the logic of this consumerism to fulfilling human needs, then we can do a real trick. And the third issue, which is worth mentioning, why some of the changes are not happening as quickly as we would like, as you asked, is that any transition to a more sustainable society and economy is not possible if it's not fair, just, transparent. And in too many cases, people have in the past invested in good faith, and they need now to understand that some of those investments were going against some of the most precious thing which we want to protect. And that means that we need to help with public laws, with public money, those that they are able to go from one situation to another situation. And in many cases we have actually created a world when the wealth is not distributed in the right way. And also the world in which environmental damage, so actually we are privatizing the profits and socializing the costs in that respect. And in that kind of a world, of course, the transition is difficult. So you need to take these societal, social parts also into consideration and make the transition which is fair, inclusive, justified, and which takes that into account. Or, of course, many will simply defend the interest which currently they hold, and then anything, any change, it's very difficult, and certainly you don't achieve it quickly.
Yeah, it's a little bit, you respond already. My next question is, you know, when we see the past, the present, the future, you work for sure now on the present. But yes, the mind, as you say, is different now. But when we see it now, for sure, the time is passing. Is it really going in the bad direction? How looks the future? When you see, even as a commissioner, when you see your career in the last 20 years, where are we standing now? And do we really skeptic about the future? Must we be scared?
Yeah, I think we should be scared, because somehow the things which we are seeing and facing as the overall consequences of the human activity, in particular economics, are driving us in the wrong direction. So everything what we see with the climate change, also with social story, distribution of wealth, disappearing life, biodiversity disappearing, all this and a lot of pollution which is around us, all these are frightening trends and not easy to change. And I think we have to understand that what would be at this moment needed, it's pretty much recognition of that fact. And I think that we are very close to that. Practically, we are in agreement that the transition of production and consumption to a more sustainable one, socially, economically, and environmentally, it's unavoidable.
Yeah.
It's necessary.
Yeah.
But we are not yet in agreement how urgent that is. So the urgency, it's, I think, not existing yet. But if you would ask me what is currently most needed in Europe, but also globally, but definitely in Europe, my advice would be that we create a kind of intergenerational agreement, a kind of a program for the next generation or for the next generations, where we would put sustainability first. I think that's essential. It's very much in line also with so-called sustainable development goals, which political leaders adopted a few years ago, a commitment which gives hope to everybody. And it's very much aligned also with the needs of the voices which are coming from the streets, of the workers of today, but also of the future generations, which are worried about the consequences, in particular, of the climate change.
Yeah, because Europe is an example. Do you think, even with the United Nations, that Europe is this example for other countries in the world to follow this movement?
Europe has done one thing decades ago after the Second World War. We have, to avoid wars and conflicts, we have decided that we'll cooperate more. So we are, in many areas, sharing sovereignty instead of owing sovereignty. We have many problems today, but it is for certain that the European project, from the point of view for what it was actually established, it's extremely successful.
Yes.
So we have to be proud of what we're doing.
Yes. It's a
peace project in the first place. And when I see the developments globally, I'm afraid that if we don't cooperate more, also on the global level, and in that respect, European project could be a kind of a pilot project from which we could learn in good and bad, then we might face the situation of more conflicts and wars in the future.
Yeah.
And I think it would be essential to understand that we are, for the first time in history, living in a socio-ecological space of planetary scope. Mm-hmm. So we are more interconnected and interdependent than ever. Even my father was still using a horse to travel from my birthplace to the town, which was 20 kilometers from there. Today, we are globally interconnected.
Yeah.
Trade, economy, internet, transport. Mm-hmm. Even we have created so much arms around us that we can basically destroy the world very quickly. So it's really fragile, and our individual and collective responsibility to govern the world, it's now much bigger than it was just a generation ago. That's why European project is so beautiful. It's basically answering to those concerns. And I think it's really worth that we do understand that cooperation is there. That more cooperation is needed.
Yeah.
More of the sharing is needed. And by the way, that's exactly the reason why I see really the Brexit is very tragic, because it goes exactly in the wrong direction as the overall need of cooperation is asking us to go.
Yes. Maybe last question, what can a small citizen do? Because everybody's asking themselves, what can I do? How can they contribute? Or is there anything they can do? Or is it really in the hands of politics and folk? Mm.
There are no small citizens. Everybody has its voice. It's important in those days where we are mastering the technologies and social media very much, the voice of everybody can be heard.
Yeah.
And it's important that it is heard, that it is active. So I very much support the activities also of the young generation, which have awakened. To be frank, I don't see it so much as a symbol of the success of the young awakened generation. Mm-hmm. I see it more as a symbol and the sign of a failure of the old generation, mm-hmm. because that's what they are pointing to.
Yes.
And I think that that each of us should basically, in the first place, consider how we are living, but in the second place, if it's not satisfied with where and how the things are governed, where and how the policies go, raise the voice, be vocal, be active, because that's the way how we can show that the things and the future do matter for us.
Yes. Maybe a very last question, it's not to the politician or it's to Janis, the citizen. What do you still want to achieve in your life, private or in politics or whatever?
You know, there are always coincidences which are leading your life. I'm currently extremely satisfied with what I'm doing.
Mm-hmm.
I think I'm doing the things which do matter for individual citizen, but also for the humanity as such. And I'm really happy doing that. I'm not the youngest anymore, but one thing which I would still like to continue, it's playing volleyball, because I play it three times a week.
Okay. No, thank you very much for this kind of interview and for your positive energy for sure. You were awarded with the champion, the United Champions Earth Award even.
Yeah, indeed.
So really incredible person. Thank you
it's
very much.
It's a responsibility which I have to bear.
No, it's simple. So thanks everybody outside for listening. As you heard, yes, the future looks not so great, but we are positive and he is positive. And as he said, our voice is heard. So open your voice when there's anything wrong and do your very best to save the planet, to do anything, really to do anything and to talk about it to other people. Stay positive, because what I always say, what you give to other people, you get back. Thanks much for listening. Bye bye.